Good morning, professors. On the behalf of our principal, director, dean, and our HOD computer science, Dr. M. Sakthi ma'am, and our team computer science department, Nalamuthu Kounder Mahalingam College, I take this opportunity to welcome you all for this 7-day national level faculty development program. Today, resource person is Ms. R. Dravidaselvi. She has 13 years of IT industry experience. She first worked as a software engineer in Tech Mahindra. At present, she is working as senior associate in CTS. She has excellent knowledge on database management system and successfully completed many projects. More than that, we have good friendship for more than 15 years from that. I know that she is very hardworking and good talented person. More than she is a gold medalist in Master of Computer Application, MCA. So with this few introduction, I welcome our resource person, Ms. R. Dravidaselvi, to present his knowledge on an introduction to NoSQL database. Welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Nandu. Good morning, everyone. It's nice to meet you all. I'm really overwhelmed to be part of this particular session, which is a 7-day FTP session. As Nandu said, I have been working for Cognizant for around like 8 years. And prior to that, I was also working for another company, my previous company, on the database management system. As and when the technology is advanced, we were also supposed to move to a different thing. And when you see the today's topic, then introduction to NoSQL databases, I had been working on this particular topic for around 2 years. And I also have hands-on experience of a few of the databases, which I'm going to explain you here. With that, I'm going to start with my session. Please drop me a note or in the chat window if you have any questions or queries. I can address you as and when it's possible. I also want the session to be interactive. There are like few questions that is been asked. If you know the answers, I would request you to put it in the chat window, the reply to the chat window, so that we will be able to have an interactive session. Because once we go with that, the voice communications, I think there will be some disturbances. So it would be better if we go with the chat window. Okay. Am I audible to you all, first of all?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Thank you.
So the participants are muted so that they won't hear.
Okay. Yes. Sure. Yes. Now, coming to the topic, an introduction to NoSQL databases. I have seen the agenda for the last 6 sessions. I could see there were like few topics that were covered on machine learning and big data and other advanced stuff. So with that, could any one of you say what is an expansion for NoSQL? There are like almost 3 different things that we can say for NoSQL. If anyone has some idea what this NoSQL is going to be, an explanation, or just an expansion for what it is. Okay. Any response to this? Okay, I think people are still logging in. Okay, let me start up with this. The NoSQL databases can be called in 3 different ways. That is, non-SQL, non-relational databases, non-relational data SQL databases, and also NoSQL, nothing but SQL. Okay, this can be called in 3 different ways. And as part of today's agenda, we are going to cover these topics. What are the history of databases? That is, what are the evolution period? And what is the RDBMS? And why are we going with NoSQL? And in that NoSQL, what are the aggregate data models? That is, which particular NoSQL has to be used for which particular projects? And what are the characteristics of NoSQL? Base versus ACID and the CAP theorem. To be very frank, I just covered the topics for history of databases and RDBMS as quickly as possible so that we would have enough time to cover the other aspects of NoSQL, because we have only 1 hour of time. So we'll just proceed with the history of databases and RDBMS as soon as possible. Yeah, history of databases. When we see the history of databases, we have learned a lot in our RDBMS chapters. It is like it has emerged as part of 1970 using the code relational model, where it was been established the data to be handled as part of database structures with the relational schemas and stuff. And slowly how they gradually form their own transformations, and today it is in the form of NoSQL DB. So each and every part there has to be in a transformation as part of the databases based on the real-time need. So when we are in the current situation, we could see the volume of data has become tremendously increased. To be considering with a simple example that we are also part of college, to consider as a simple example, if a college is started newly as part of this year, say for example, on 2015, let's consider 2015, a college has been started. We would hardly have few students as part of the every departments. Say for example, 30 each department, and if it holds 10 departments, 30 into 10, it's hardly 300 members. Gradually, when the years go on, like every year we keep increasing the strength. At that point of time, as a part of our college management system, we should hold the details of all the students studied in the college for those years. Along with that, they also have to hold the data of all those stats. Okay, now it's just 5 years, 2015 to 2020, it's hardly 5 years. What if the college is running that for around 100 years? How many number of departments? There will be new departments that will be emerging every year. And as part of it, there will be a lot of students coming in and going out. In the 100 years, it's not necessary that there will be only 30 students in a department. The volume will be increasing. So in that way, it's just for a simple college level, one particular college level, when we are considering the data, we could see the volume of data has been increased. Okay, just imagine the real-time systems, a banking sector, and the other things, like for example, Facebook. If you see, every day the volume of records are increasing more and more. The data, it's unimaginable. We are unable to store the database into our simple systems, and we are now emerging into the cloud points. So that's when the history of databases has now been evolved into NoSQL. Because we'll see some, we'll just go with the benefits of RDBMS, and then we'll proceed with why we are going for SQL. RDBMS, when we initially started with our database management system, it was not expected to be a huge volume, okay? So when we are having a simple applications like a hospital management system or college management systems or a simple company management system, employee management systems, everything we have, we will able to use the RDBMS successfully because they had that asset transactions. We had the features. Can some of you explain what does an asset transaction mean? Can I have some response in the chat window, please? What is asset? Yeah, atomicity. That's for A, consistency. Yes, that's good.
Isolation.
That's for C, isolation.
Integrity. And durability.
Durability, yeah, you're right. That's good. So this is the asset transactions. So our RDBMS current structures will help us to perform all these particular transactions efficiently. And you have the concurrency and recovery models. When your database is down, you can easily recover by backups and other stuff, and it is very trustable. And if you have to do some aggregate functionalities as part of it, a mathematical thing, so you will have to perform a lot of transactions, a lot of calculations based on it. Say, for example, a salary system. In that, you have to take your basic pay and you have to do a lot of calculations. For that also, it will be of ease. A standard query language. SQL, a simple SQL can retrieve all your data, performing all those mathematical things and gives you the expected result. And they also enable you with providing the reporting facility. Okay, with all these parts of benefits of RDBMS, still it has been successful, but not for all. what are the drawbacks of RDBMS? As we said, RDBMS will be it's a relational database. We are not planning for the distribution here. Like when big data is emerging, we could say the data is being distributed across the different clusters, correct? When we consider the RDBMS, if it's been distributed among the clusters, how are we going to retrieve the data? We'll be using the joins, correct? The joins within a single system, it's okay. The joins will be quite easy and it will be cost effective. Think if the joins are supposed to happen during the multiple distributed systems, how are we going to join? It's much expensive. And the time taken to retrieve all those data from the distributed systems will be high. You cannot even expect the time consumption. Okay. And for this particular RDBMS system, again, it's a cost consuming one. So these are the drawbacks of RDBMS. And it is also weak in speed. As I said, we have to go to each and every distributed systems and try to retrieve the data as part of it. And when you go and see, the turnaround time will be very, very, very huge. And it will not be available at all parts. That's when we had emerged with the big data to handle with such high volumes of data. Now, I just wanted to know what are the three V's of big data. Three V's of big data.
Velocity, volume, and
velocity. Yeah, correct. Why are we going with velocity? Good. I'm seeing a very good response from the audience. Thank you all. Velocity, variety, and variance. Volume. Because when we say velocity, a simple example is Facebook. Every day, somebody posts a photo or video or some shares, and it's been liked by many and it's been commented by many. Are we expecting that we are expecting only few comments or data or few comments or a few likes or few other shares in a day? No, right? It's unpredictable. So the velocity keeps increasing, and also the variety of data. What kind of varieties we have? It's an image, it's a video, it's simple text. A lot of things are there. Okay, in that point of time, how are we going to manage the data as part of RDBMS? That's when we had come out into the NoSQL overview. The NoSQL provides you the mechanism for storage and retrieval. It's other than tabular column, it's an other way of storing a database, a data in the form of NoSQL. There are different formats for that. You can use JSON format, you can use XML format, and there are a lot of other stuffs also, okay? This particular NoSQL, if you ask where it can be used in all big data and web applications. And it can also be used in a real-time application. It's just that when you're trying to use a web applications, instead of pointing it to your database, it will be referring to the NoSQL documents. It will try to retrieve all those documents and it will present you to a UI layer, that is a web layer. And all these transformations can also be done. Because whenever we are designing an application, right, we will have a different layers. Normally in the corporate systems or even when your projects that we do, we'll not just put all those contingents in a single layer. We will have a retrieval layer, that is a UI layer, and then we will have a business processing layer. And behind that, we will also have an interaction with the DB. So your UI level will be the ultimate top level where only the users will be able to see. And remaining other stuff will be handled in these other layers. So when we go for this particular real-time applications and web applications, all your transformations that you do as part of the databases will be automatically handled in your transformation layer. And when you see the schema, when you go for the relational database, we already said like it's a form of tables and columns. We have some restrictions over there, like integrity and so on. When we go with that, if there is a column that is mandatory and it is not available as part of your part of your data, it will fail. Also, if you have like 10 columns, that is not necessary that all your particular record should have all those 10 columns, correct? So there are situations where only 5 columns are available and remaining 5 columns are unavailable. It has to be marked as null. In your database management system, what we do, for every record, you will have one, for every data, you will have one record. and all those record will have 10 columns, all 10 columns to be populated. Think about the memory. Also, for all the 5 columns, you will have the memory allocated for those records. But when we are trying to emerge into the big data, I mean, NoSQL, what happens is it will have the data only for whatever volume or attributes that is available. Okay, we said like 10 columns, but when you consider the big data, when you consider the NoSQL, there are only 5 columns available. Okay, just pick up the 5 columns and allocate the document for that alone. In future, if you are receiving the 6th column, then you go ahead and add one more column for that. Unless it is a mandatory column, the rest of other columns will not be considered as a mandatory ones, and you will not have the memory allocated for that. In this way, your document saving is also easier, and the point of retrieval is also much easier. That's when we say the structure and semi-structure and unstructured data. This is how we are going to say the things. And when we said like for ACID transactions, and the ACID is for the RDBMS and basis for the NoSQL, we'll see towards the end of the session. As we discussed before, why did we go for NoSQL? That's a driving trend. As we said, it's a distributed environment. When we go with the RDBMS structure, it would be very difficult for us to retrieve all those. So that's when we have the big data and clouds, etc., and machine learning, everything is in progress. It's in process, and every customers and clients, they have started accumulating all those data into the big data and clouds. Next is the performance. The performance decreases in RDBMS when the data increases. So that's why we are trying to move to NoSQL. Now, we'll go for the NoSQL characteristics. When you see about the NoSQL, it avoids the ACID transactions. And its complexity of SQL query, we will not have an SQL query as part of NoSQL. Instead, we will have some APIs defined and we'll be working based on those APIs. We also have an option for the user to query via the SQL. It's based on the drivers that you use for every database. You need not go with the schema design. As we said, we have 5 columns. And if we have to go for the RDBMS, we have to see what all the columns are available. Then we have to bring up with the normalization techniques. And we have to identify and confirm whether it matches everything or not. But when you go for the NoSQL, you need not worry about anything. Tomorrow, if for now you have 5 columns, tomorrow another one is added, just add a part of it to the document. It will help you in retrieving the data later. And transactions, as we said, the transactions can happen via the API that you are building. That will be in the application layer. As we discussed, we will have the multiple layers in our raw. And wherever you're trying to use the business transactions, you can apply all those logics into the transaction layer. With the above said things, we could also see that it provides a frequent changes to DB. That is, we need not change every time the schema level because it's automatically open. You can add whenever you want, and you can also remove whenever you need. You can also handle large volumes of data. And it doesn't have any schema. You can go with the data what you currently have. And there are most of the companies, they started accommodating to the NoSQL, like for Facebook, Google, they have started moving into the NoSQL DBs. And now we are coming to the basic things of data, NoSQL. Not all the documents and not all the data can be stored in the same way. It's based on your requirements, right? You will have a different requirement on how we are going to design your database. So basically, these DBs are classified into 4 models. One is a key value, document, column family, and graph. To my right, I had given a small screenshot which I have taken from sites, an example for each and every document, and how they interact with the data that we have, and how it is feasible for you to use these kind of data models, and for which particular project you have to use this particular data models. So there are 4 things again. Key value, document, column family, and graph. Key data model. If you say about the key data model, right, it's a very simple form of the NoSQL databases. It will be easy to store the data and retrieve the data. Okay, say for example, I have shown a picture here. The key is dog, and this is the only key. And all the values corresponding to this dog 12 will be stored under name, mood, the birth date, and etc. So this is the key, and all the values concerned to this will be stored in a document. Okay. With this, what we can do is when we have to retrieve the data for a particular case, say for now I have given only dog 12. I can have so many number of other dogs, right? There can be any number of varieties of dog. Say for example, you also have another, say for example, car. You have a car. If you consider the Maruti Suzuki or Swift Desire, anything model you take. And you also have another. Okay, now I consider Maruti Suzuki. What are the models? What are the different models you have? It can be, it can vary on the day, ZDI, XDI. You have a lot of models, and you also have the lot of colors. So when I go and query with the model as Maruti Suzuki here, it will give me all the details of that. Under name, it will have different models, ZDI, VDI, etc., etc. And date of manufacture, it will have the date of manufacture, so all these things being appended. And which colors you have there, everything will be put in there. So it is very key. It's very simple, right? When I wanted to go and query, okay, I wanted to get the details of Maruti. Go check with this key and provide all this value here. Tomorrow, if I have to add another color to the particular model, I'll just go to this one, add the another model, just one another attribute to this document. It will be all set. I can go and retrieve the data. So all these things will be taken by the pair of key and value. What is a key? What is a value? Okay. So it's a very simple one. We can use the hash tables. We can access the data by using the keys. And as usual, we don't have any specific format here. You can go with any format you want. And you can also update it in the future point. You can also delete it whenever it's not possible. Say, for example, in the current thing, if you don't have a data model, for a car, a particular model is not available, you can go ahead and you can delete that. Everything will be possible as part of key value data model. Moving on to the document data model. It has a complex, little complex data structure. Actually, to be frank, my experience is mostly based on this document model. Here the data will be stored in the as a part of documents. See, here the example which I have given is, this is the one which we had earlier, a key and a document. And now when you go for doc 12, you could see a JSON document. The one which is to my right, this is a JSON document, and you can see the groups, name, type, mood, birth date, box. And here within box, I have a different comments to that added. Okay, so it is a nested in sense, I have a birth date. Again, for box, I have a multiple comments for that box. So it can also be nested, and you can also store the documents effectively. This I can again go with your simple college example. I have it's only the staff details. I have a staff here. He's just joined newly. And what, according to our database system, we will have only her name, what is her graduation. The graduation could be in two ways. She can, they might have been a part of a UG holder if it's an engineering background, or they can also be a master degree, or they can also have a PG degree, correct? So in that case, if you see the name, type or sex, birth date, these all you'll be having with only one single value. But when you go for your degree certificates or whatever the course they have completed, you could see the multiple things that is popping up. Say there are like a lot of staffs who have done their PhD in different aspects. PhD in big data, PhD in RDBMS, PhD in machine learning, so many things are there. So if you come back here, say for this one, this particular part I'm talking about. When you come back here, they would have, okay, PG degree one, PhD one, under what they have done. And under that, you will have some several subsystems under what topics they have done and how much they have earned, what comments they have received so far. So when we go, consider when we go for the RDBMS sample, what happens? For one particular staff, you will be having multiple records level, correct? Staff number one, they have considered PhD one. Staff number one, they have done the PhD two. Staff three, done the PhD three. In these two PhD three, if there are like different topics they have taken, again, for each and everything, you will have a different record, correct? But when you come to this particular document model, it is made simple. You will have only one staff and that particular staff details and what all the PhD degrees they have folded and what comments they have received so far. It's done in a single document. That is, which we talk about, it's a part of single record. Everything has been handled. If you go with the RDBMS system, what we do is, you'll be creating a normalization technique where you will hold the PhD degrees in one table and other topics in another table. You will try to link all those things, correct? And you think about the performance, taking the staff number one, go fetch their PhD details, whether they have done or not. If they have done, move to the table to fetch what kind of topics they have taken. After that, consider what other things they have, comments they have received so far. It's a huge headache, right? So now with this, we can just take, okay, staff number one, give me the details. Just a simple API or a simple interactive queries which you write. You can get all those details in a single thing. This can also be used as part of XML documents. This is a JSON document which I've explained, but my experience is as part of the XML documents. Moving on to the column family model. It is the smallest instance of data. I think we have to, another confirm me, we have to join in a different link. Okay, I'll try to log into a different meeting invite. I think it's going to end in next 1 minute. Next, we are moving into a third family model, that is the column family model. With this example, if you could see a row and what is a column and the titles and what is it. So here, what they're trying to see is they're going to group it based on the fields. If I say dog, what is the color of the dog, mood, name, everything matters, right? So they have grouped it as part of the column. And next, again, with additional category, there it is, except for that one, their voice. It is a physical thing, right? Whatever the color and everything is a physical one, whereas the bark is the one, each and every capacity or efficiency of a particular animal. Okay? It contains a name and its particular value. That is the column family model. We have like a lot of organizations that we have a lot of volumes of data that keep increasing on a daily basis. So we have to deploy a data that is highly effective. The database system stores and retrieves data from physical drives. The major major problem that will be faced with the business will be like, they have to do the analytical and their query intensive operations. Okay, when we look into the other models, the document model and your key based model, when you look into the analytical things, it was just used for retrieving, right? But when we have to go with actual querying and actually getting the analytics as part of it, that will be quite difficult as part of the other two models. Whereas when we come to this particular column family model, we have each and everything grouped as part of your columns. So you can provide your queries, you can provide your analytic operations on part of this particular data column-oriented model. That's the family model. If you see what are the special features of column family model, you have the data storage. It's similar to the RDBMS. Here you have the wide column databases. So user can store the data as part of different columns and their values. And data manipulations, again, you can also manipulate. See, it is a simple thing I have given, right? If suppose there are like other criteria like employee and their salary and stuff, basic and everything, if you are putting it into the column family model, you could see they can be easily calculated. And they also have the self-indexing. Column indexed. Okay, now I have to go with only the personal details. Go fetch the personal details. Next one, I have to go with the salary sections. This is just an example. It's here. I'm just giving you another live example. Say for example, here we have the salary. My index would go to the salary. The scalability. So the scalability is like they can store data as in columns rather than rows. It allows to spread data across many computing nodes. It's not necessary that it has to be stored in one particular system. Say for example, for this particular example which I have said, if this is stored in one cluster, the other salary details can be stored in a different cluster. So what happens is, whenever you wanted to retrieve the data, it will be distributed across. So it's not necessary that it has to be placed in the same cluster to retrieve those. Whenever you want the specific information, so you will have the data available in different nodes, go fetch that data and provide it over there. So it will be distributed and it will be easy for retrieval even if the data volume increases as day and day. And compression. The next one would be the compression. You can compress this particular databases and store the data by row. It will be similar to that of your RDBMS, but the only thing is the way they store will be different than part of the RDBMS. This is the column family model. Next one is the graph model. I think graph model would be pretty clear to you all. When we look into this particular thing, we could see the graph. I mean, it's a kind of neural networking kind of things, right? It's not in a specific order. It's being grouped. And other thing also can be compared. For example, your GPS system. GPS system only on roads, not on the satellite vision. Only on road vision, if you take, you can see the squares and other stuff, right? You will have the different routes to come to a particular start and end point. So this is particularly based on the graph theory. It is mostly used for the data sets, mapping directly to data structures of the object-oriented applications. Here, if you see, it is, okay, for example, if we are in some particular point of the country and you want a particular city you consider, you have taken to a particular city, and you wanted to go to your nearest hotel or the nearest lodge where you have to stay. What you do is you normally take your mobile or laptop, you just search for a place. We don't have any joints. What are the thing that is necessary? What is the current location? What are the in and around areas for your dining or for your lodges to stay? When you just go and click on that, it will give you the lot of options. Here, we have not joined anything with that. What we did is we just chose the one which is in and around of your particular location. So based on this, we had used some algorithm to map the locations that are close to you. With that, you'll be able to choose a restaurant which you have to have your food and also a hotel where you have to go for your stay. Okay. They are more suitable for ad hoc and changing data. Same thing. Today, now you are in a particular location. You are finding some data in and around you. Next, immediately you're moving to a different street or different location, different city. Automatically, it gets changed to that particular city. It is not going to search from the one where you were initially and then pick up the data. It's then going for your current location and then it will go and fetch for this one. So it is an ad hoc basis. It will change the data based on your particular thing. So here also you can have the asset transactions as possible. And few of the examples that use a graph data model is ArangoDB and NeoG. Now, when we come for the base versus asset, as we said, asset is for RDBMS and base is for R NoSQL. What is asset? Atomic, consistent, isolated, and durable. As you all know. Now we'll come for atomic. Each task in a transaction succeeds, the entire transactions and rollback. Consistent. isolated, durable. I think everybody would know about it. Now we'll come for Base. That is for a NoSQL. It is basically available for BA. The system is guaranteed to be available in event of failure. Can someone say what could be the reason for that? When we say even if it is a failure, you will have the data available. Can we say what could be the reason for it? Any idea? I did not see any response. Maybe able. Yes, the reason could be they are okay. Let me come back with the answer for that. We see the data are being stored under the different nodes, right? Let me see if they have received a response. Log file. No, it's simple. It is distributed. It's distributed, right? When you go for the RDBMS, it's not distributed. So whenever the thing is down, you will not be able to retrieve the data. But whereas when we go for your NoSQL, it's been distributed. So when even when the data is down, you'll be able to pick them up. Soft state. The state of data could change without the application interaction due to event consistency. Yes, in RDBMS, as we said, we need to have, if there are 10 columns, you need to have all the 10 columns. But when we come to our NoSQL, even though we have only 5 columns, our space will be allocated only to the 5 columns that are available. Next is the eventual consistency. Even after application is input, the data will be replicated to different nodes and will eventually reach to a consistent state. But consistency is not guaranteed at the transaction level. True. Because we have the big data architecture, right? How the every transactions are being stored. If suppose a particular node is failed, you will have only the bulk of transactions and you will not have the most recent transactions. So you will have the history of this, but not at the each transaction level. That is our base. Basically available, soft state, and eventual consistency. And CAP theorem. This basically drives our NoSQL. CAP, consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. In RDBMS, if you see, only CA would be there, consistency and availability. And here, if you see, each and every of your NoSQL databases will not have all your particular things available, captured or handled. RDBMS would consider consistency and availability, whereas the CouchDB, Cassandra, and DynamoDB, which are like few document or key value databases, they'll have you the availability and partition tolerances. When you go for MongoDB, HBase, Redis, they will provide you the consistency and the partition tolerances. What is a CAP? Every read receives the most recent write or an error. Whenever you're trying to read a data, that will give you the recent write. Okay, if not a recent write, an error. Availability. Every request receives a non-error response without the guarantee that it contains the most recent write. Partition. The system continues to operate despite of an arbitrary number of messages being dropped or delayed by the network between nodes. So when we see here, we have the consistency and availability. What is it? Every read will have the most recent write. And you have the commit and other stuffs in the RDBMS. So you can easily handle with that. Availability. So the data will be available with whichever is non-error situations, you will have those data available. The error data will not be available here. So these things will be handled by the RDBMS. Again, the non-error response with the most recent write and the partition tolerances delayed by the network. These two will be handled over our document and field level databases. We had given our few examples in the every slides, whichever data models we follow. And next thing, consistency and partition things, which will have the most recent write and it will have got the guarantee. It contains the most recent write. This is a part of the CAP theorem. This has been basically driven for the NoSQL databases. Now, we have to consider when we have to use NoSQL and when we have to use an RDBMS. A NoSQL database will be highly efficient and highly helpful when you have a semi-structured or unstructured data and your schema is flexible. And you have a very limited predefined paths and query patterns. There are no complex queries, no stored procedures that are required for this. You can have some manipulations, but that can be handled via your transaction layers. And when your volume of transactions are more, and you cannot imagine your data volume keeps increasing as every day, like Google or Facebook, at that point of time, you can go with NoSQL. And if you require a distributed computing, rather the non-distributed ones, if we go for the distributing, and you have to go with this. And it's not a data warehouse, and it is used for your analytical and PI purpose, you can go with your NoSQL. And you have to choose RDBMS. You have, when you have the asset transaction requirement, complex and dynamic queries that you need and perform everything, migrate the databases without an existing application. See, say for example, the applications, they are, we can see most of the customers are now moving from the RDBMS to NoSQL. But there are still few who are moving to a cloud, but they're not ready to give up their RDBMS system. Just because they wanted to use their existing structures in place without having any change to their existing structures. At that point of time, we have to go with the RDBMS. And you need a data warehouse and analytics or BI use cases. Okay. Okay. With this, I'm going to ask a few questions. Okay, I want one line answer for that. Graph more data model, when can we use a simple one? At when can we use the graph model? Or we can go with this. Does NoSQL require a normalization?
No, ma'am.
No, yeah, correct. Okay, what is NoSQL, a full form of NoSQL? I said like three, we have three different things. I just want to know what are the NoSQL expansions. NoSQL, correct? NoSQL, not only SQL and non-relational SQL. Now, when we discuss with few things, right? Is NoSQL a static or dynamic schema? When can we consider NoSQL? During the static schema or the dynamic schema? Correct, it's dynamic schema. Because static, we already have a predefined columns and rows set up in our RDBMS system. So we'll go for dynamic schema, where your schema gets changing every now and then. Then, is JSON or XML a structured or non-structured data? Maybe it's all simple questions for experience level, but just wanted to know. JSON and XML, are they structured or unstructured data? Unstructured. Correct. Okay. Can someone give me a simple example where the graph can be used? Graph schema can be used. Graph data model. Map, true. We also have some of our day-to-day activities. Some people cannot live without it. GPS, correct. Correct, that's the best answer, FB. They got addicted and we cannot go with that. That's true. Predictions. Correct. Okay. I hope you all have enjoyed the session. Do we have any questions or queries? You can just post it over the chat.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, hi.
Selvi, you can ask again whether there is any doubt or clarification.
Yeah, you can have. Do we have any questions or queries? How NoSQL relate to big data? Yeah. I think Shakti ma'am has asked this question. Ma'am, you have that big data concept. Let's say, for example, Facebook. Facebook, if you see every day, you keep adding a lot of friends to yours. Right, and you also have likes and comments. If you have four different friends and you have provided four different likes to your friends on photos or shares, whatever they do, it will be when you go and look into the data, right? If you go to the normal RDBMS system, what happens is you will not be able to go and fetch them everything, correct? When it is coming to your big data, it is all stored in the part of clusters, which is like the nodes are different. You'll have a set of indexing and things happen to every part of the partitioning and everything. So for your particular particular list and particular photo, you will have your name or your friends that you have been tagged. If you go to a particular friend, and it is not like you have your name and what all the shares or photos that you have liked to be saved in a single thing. Instead, you'll go to the particular person of your friend. On that, if you go and save under their photo, you will have the likes. This is why it's in this process. Okay. With that, we can able to go and fetch the, if you go and take a photo of yours or a chance of a particular, if you go and take a particular friend's share, if I see who have liked that one, it will go to the particular person's ID and it will try to fetch all those details from them. Rather, getting it from your information, it will go there. If it is going from your end, it will take a time-consuming process, whereas when you go to there, it will be stored as a part of document for that particular shares and you can have them linked. Which is better compared to SQL and MySQL? MySQL and NoSQL. See, it's very simple. It's same like NoSQL and things, right? MySQL, it has, again, it's an RDBMS concept. And you will have certain things. Whatever the RDBMS is applicable, it could be applicable for MySQL as well. Whereas when for the NoSQL, you will not have any specific schema level. I could see that MySQL or NoSQL, it all depends on what kind of projects you do. And what is the client requirements and so on. If the client insists to have the asset, then definitely you should go with your MySQL. And if that is not required and they only need the base or a CAP theorem to be followed, then you obviously have to go for your NoSQL. Okay, thank you all. I hope you enjoy the session. If you have any questions or queries, you can drop an email. I'll try to get your answers. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Good morning to all. So this is Nandakumar from Computer Science Department. Vote of thanks. On the behalf of our Computer Science Department, Dr. M. Sakthi Madam, HOD, and the Computer Science team, I like to thank all our resource person, Ms. R. Dravidaselvi, for her wonderful presentation and made the session more interactive. It's really knowledgeable session for all of us. It's clearly explained about joins, why we move to NoSQL, and what is the different data models we have, just like column, graphs, and about CAP theorem, and so on. Ma'am, it's really a wonderful session. Even though from your busy schedule, you accepted this session for 1 hour. Thank you very much for your presentation. It's very much useful for us. Also, I thank our principal sir, director sir, dean sir, and management for their support. Also, I thank all the parties, professors from various institutions and our own institution for their patient listening. Once again, I thank you all for your patient listening. Thank you all. Stay home, stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you all.